Macmillan Audio presents Savage Messiah, How Dr. Jordan Peterson is Saving Western Civilization by Jim Proser. Foreword and introduction read by the author. Narrated by Danny Campbell.
For Adelaide, my one and only. Foreword. There is a famous Jewish legend that holds that, at any given time, there are 36 righteous people in the world. Thanks to these people, the world continues to exist. Were it not for them, humanity would collapse into such evil that it would consume itself and essentially cease to exist. Neither we nor they know who these individuals are. I do not take this legend literally. I assume there are more than 36 righteous people in the world. But I do take it seriously. Its point is entirely accurate. We all know the power of the truly evil to wreak havoc on Earth. Therefore, some truly good people have to counterbalance them. The deck is stacked against the good. It is far easier for one individual to do great evil than for one individual to do great good. Any pathetic soul can murder dozens of people. But other than some physicians, how many people can save dozens of lives? Jordan Peterson is one of those rare people. Needless to say, if you know anything about the man, you know that he would scoff at this idea. Once, when I asked him at a public dialogue if he believed in God, he answered that he didn't think he was good enough to be able to say that he did. In his view, to believe in God is so morally demanding, he cannot imagine who can truly say they believe in God. I can only say, as one who does believe in God, that while Jordan may not be certain he believes in God, I am certain God believes in Jordan. At the end of each day in the Genesis creation story, it says, "And God saw it was good." Only after creating the human being does the text say, "And God saw it was very good." Jordan Peterson is one of those rare people who wants to be very good. I think he is. Not just a very good psychologist, husband, and father, but a very good human being. But what distinguishes Jordan most is the rarest of the good traits, courage. Many people are ethical, have integrity, and regularly show kindness. But few good people have courage. Jordan does. It was his courage that brought him to the public's attention. He refused to be cowed by the Orwellian bullies of political correctness, who in the province of Ontario have passed laws governing what pronouns a person must use when speaking or addressing people. Decent man that he is, Jordan Peterson would never intentionally insult a person. As he has repeatedly made clear, if someone looks and dresses as a female and has a female name, he will refer to this person as she, whether the person is transgender or not. Likewise, if a person looks and dresses as male and has a male name, he will refer to this person as he. But if a bearded person wearing a skirt demands to be referred to as she, Jordan might not acquiesce and will not allow Ontario to tell him that he must. Such a stance takes courage today, especially in the least open and most intolerant institution of our time, the university. As a result of his remarkable ability to intellectually, rationally, and coolly respond to hostile interviewers the world over, Jordan became an international sensation, particularly among young people. And why is that? There is no definitive answer to that question, but allow me to suggest a few. No generation in modern history has been deceived by their elders as much as the past two generations have, especially in the English-speaking countries. Most young people do not realize this. How could they? If the people who present reality to you, most particularly your teachers and the news and entertainment media, tell you the earth is flat, why would you assume it is round? But many young people suspect they haven't heard the whole truth. At the very least, many of them realize they have not been exposed to any other view of the world, of good and evil, or of Western civilization. So when an obviously decent, honest, erudite intellectual came along and spoke to them about good and evil, about meaning in life, and how to be a more fulfilled and ultimately happier person, millions of them responded with enthusiasm. Young people need adults to provide a model and to provide wisdom. Jordan Peterson has become that adult for millions of them, and he has especially touched young men, because too many adult men since as far back as the 1970s have chosen not to become men, but to remain boys. Combined with the deliberate emasculating of a generation of men by feminists, of both sexes, countless boys and men are lost. The subtitle of this biography is How Dr. Jordan Peterson is Saving Western Civilization. It is not overstated. That is how important Jordan Peterson's life and work are. Dennis Prager. Dennis Prager is co-founder of Prager University, which garners more than a billion views a year, a nationally syndicated radio talk show host, syndicated columnist, and author of 9 best-selling books, including the first 2 volumes of The Rational Bible, a projected 5-volume commentary on the Torah. Introduction. I discovered Jordan Peterson on YouTube and was immediately captivated by his use of language. There was a musicality to it. He spoke in a rush of barely comprehensible scientific concepts taken to a crescendo, and then stopped in a long, unexpected silence. He was speaking some form of elevated Canadian English. I stopped that first video and took a moment to digest what I'd just heard. I thought he was warning me about something called postmodern neo-Marxism, whatever that was. I restarted the video from the beginning. I saw that Peterson's long, unexpected silences were spontaneous moments of introspection, often in the middle of bursts of scientific observations. He was parsing his words, not to make them more palatable or to protect himself, but the opposite. He was making them more precise and frequently more inaccessible. He used phrases like the proper level of analysis and agreeableness is one of the traits associated closely with creativity. This was definitely over my head, but he challenged me to keep up by interjecting a Will Rogers-style, plain-spoken reflection. So what the hell's going on here exactly? And why are we damn near at each other's throats? He spoke in terms of psychometrics, an area of science that measures psychological responses. He colored scientific facts with his unique understanding of human nature learned from great minds like Carl Jung, Friedrich Nietzsche, and Jean Piaget. He added the wisdom of great writers like Alexander Solzhenitsyn and Fyodor Dostoevsky. He shared his own pain openly without shame. But finally, it was his profound sensitivity to human suffering and insights into the evil in every human heart that made Jordan Peterson's message in this video unique and vital. I hope you will find here some solace in his words of wisdom, some inspiration from his heroic stand against overwhelming enemies, and some relief from the undeserved suffering in your life. Jim Prozer, Sarasota, Florida, 2019.
Chapter 1. Descent into Hell. The very fact that a general problem has gripped and assimilated the whole of a person is a guarantee that the speaker has really experienced it and perhaps gained something from his sufferings. He will then reflect the problem for us in his personal life and thereby show us a truth. Carl Gustav Jung, founder of analytical psychology. He studied the neck of the young man, a fellow student sitting in front of him. The fine hairs and gentle swell of the vertebrae were nauseating, something about their fragility and weakness. His compulsion to attack welled up, threatening to spill into the real world this time. He was suddenly in a rage, blinding and bloodthirsty. His heartbeat quickened, and his focus narrowed onto the curve of the fragile, downy hairs, fine as baby's hair, that wrapped around from the vulnerable jugulars on each side to the precise center of the delicate neck vertebrae. There they merged into a dark vertical line that marked dead center of the spinal nerve. Obviously, the hairs would be no protection at all in an attack like the one he was considering. In fact, they were pointing to prime targets and underlining the broad band of muscle where the tip of his pen would find bloody satisfaction. Somewhere inside his head, a voice close to his own was perhaps saying something like, "Doesn't he understand that the entire world is about to be wiped out in a nuclear war? Well, he and everybody else in this stupid class will bloody well wake the hell up when I'm done." He sat there, stewing in his plot of revenge for his classmates' ignorance, while he imagined world leaders preparing to vaporize them all in uranium fires of 150 million degrees Fahrenheit, 6 times hotter than the core of the sun. He had no way to think about this. He knew there was no logic to it. There was no religion or philosophy that could explain it. There was nothing but the obvious and endless examples of barbarity that had happened everywhere, every day, time and time again since the beginning of the world. The tormenting question of how did evil, global, eternal evil, operate in the world, had lately been ricocheting around inside his skull like a glowing tracer bullet, shattering his thoughts, denying him sleep, and shuttering him silently away in his room. He knew he was slipping away, now even publicly. But there was no guide rail to grip, no North Star to guide him as he stumbled down his own shadowy mineshaft toward hell and insanity. Jordan Peterson had entered the mineshaft of his own fears 7 years earlier. At the age of 13, he was already scoffing at the fairy tales being taught in his Christian confirmation class. The virgin birth? Yeah, right. Jesus rose from the dead? Oh, come on. He bristled even against the idea of this nonsense being taught in a classroom, as if it were truly education and not just a bunch of old fantasies. He believed in science. Small for his age and weighing around 100 pounds, just being around these quiet and obedient Christian kids was enough to get him kicked out of the cool crowd, the tough guys who swore, got drunk, told raunchy and highly insulting jokes, and pissed on gravestones. He didn't want to even be seen with these religious nerds. In spite of the hope of his mother, Beverly, that he would find comfort and guidance in her Christian faith, she was losing him. His father, Walter, a high school principal and teacher, was little help since he never had much to say on the subject. Although young Jordan loved and trusted his mother completely, he just couldn't believe in a God that turned a woman into a pillar of salt, or that his only son, an ordinary man, could walk on water. It was as if the twinge of anxiety in rejecting his mother's faith, the first hairline crack of adult separation from her, pushed his already overactive, nearly manic curiosity into high gear. If the Bible was baloney, what was the truth? Now he had to find out. He probably couldn't even hint at such a nerdy idea with his friends. It was his only, as if he had stepped into his own personal echo chamber of debate and closed the door behind him. Alone, then, he plunged ahead into a sort of vision quest, into the realm of heroes searching for the golden fleece, the Holy Grail, or the Great Spirit itself. With only a vague notion of direction, he turned his back on his mother's walled Garden of Eden and ran headlong toward a personal knowledge of good and evil. He knew it was somewhere down at the bedrock of human reasoning and science. It had to be. And he was in a hurry. But he already had all the knowledge about good and evil he could ever use. He'd been absorbing it through the hundreds of science fiction and adventure novels he'd read, one a day on average since he was a small boy. He recognized a bad guy instantly with just a few words of introduction, and naturally hoped they would pay for their evil deeds in the end. He'd been figuring out good and evil since he could read a newspaper at age 6. In 1968, it started with the horror of the My Lai massacre that year. Then he began to learn of the stories about the millions killed in recent world wars that filled popular books and movies. In 1975, at 13 years old, he read of the killing fields of the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia that would eventually be filled with 1.8 million political outcasts, most killed with pickaxes to save bullets. He'd already read about the tens of millions of corpses from the world wars and knew that evil people routinely operated in the open, while good people often seemed to hide in fear. God is dead, he'd heard. And religion is the opiate of the people, he'd heard. Religion was for obedient nerds, not tough guys who knew the score. Religion is evil, he'd heard. And so young Jordan, barely a teenager, challenged his confirmation class minister by asking how the man could possibly believe the Bible story of Genesis in light of the modern scientific theories of the Big Bang and evolution. Apparently, there was no satisfactory answer, only the musings of a devoted follower of Jesus Christ. This disgusted the rebel, the about-to-be-fallen angel. What he was thinking was blasphemy, and he knew it. But who cared? There was no Jesus or God to punish him anyway. He already knew that evil was something that came from outside, like the space monsters of his science fiction books, and the black-hatted gunslingers of his Western adventures who slouched into town looking for trouble. What he did know was that a special personal evil already had deep roots inside him and was growing quickly. The religious wisdom that he'd scoffed at, that might have helped him deal with it, would not be earned for many years, and only after much suffering to the point of insanity and near death. It seemed like the only guidance young Jordan followed from his trusted, devoted mother was to pursue his vision quest through the books he continued to consume by the dozen. Fortunately, she had just started as a librarian at nearby Fairview College. She was a rising star on campus, attracting students and faculty and amusing her colleagues with her fun-loving, prankster personality. Everyone soon fell for her almost as completely as Jordan had. With help from her colleagues, she was able to advise her precocious high schooler about college-level books and lectures concerning his new fascination with global politics and social issues. She was aided by Sandy Notley, Jordan's high school librarian and very influential mentor, who introduced him to the newest books of social and political commentary from George Orwell, Aldous Huxley, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, and Ayn Rand. Sandy also introduced Jordan to Canada's emerging socialist politics. She was married to Grant Notley, the leader of the socialist Alberta New Democratic Party. The NDP was even more liberal than Canada's ruling Liberal Party. Welcomed into the party by Grant, Jordan soon became an advocate for the NDP's socialist policies. With his ambition, gritty work ethic, and gift for argument, he helped push the party's advancement in Canadian politics. As he stuffed mailing envelopes and built hand placards for protest marches, he was becoming more inspired toward revolution in solidarity with oppressed laborers, farmers, and factory workers around the world. He was now proudly part of the global collective, the proletariat, who were abused and cheated in every nation on earth. These new words, collective and proletariat, could barely be understood by the uninitiated. But he, Jordan Peterson, 13 years old, was certain he'd found the path from religious ignorance toward the answer to the question that now fully possessed him. How and why does evil exist? He wanted to know how political evil overtook entire countries and apparently everyone in them. Why were some countries consistently wealthy and their people happy and successful, while others were always poor, miserable, and then overtaken by evil? Why were NATO and the Soviet Union always on the brink of self-annihilating nuclear war? How could ordinary Germans have become Nazis? How could they have committed such obviously evil acts, and so blithely as just following?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.